This video was made possible by Wix. If you're ready to create a website, head over to wix.com/go/infographics2019 to try out one of their premium plans right now. Maybe you've had a moment, most of us had, when a door opens in your mind and for a few minutes you ponder the meaning of existence. What's it all about? What are we making down here? What's the point? Suddenly, you're all too aware that you're spinning on a rock inside a possibly infinite universe. This can sometimes be a weight off your mind because, hey, your small problems don't seem to matter too much right now. But you're also perplexed at the sheer massiveness of what you don't know. You could take a leaf out of German philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer's book and know that just being nice to others and creating things gives us some meaning. But really, what are we doing here floating in space? There's a thought experiment in line with philosophical skepticism that asks, what if we're not really what we think we are? What if we're just a brain in a box, suspended in some kind of life-giving liquid, our neurons connected with wires, and those wires connected to some kind of supercomputer? In this scenario, what we perceive of the universe is only what we're programmed to perceive. There was an Irish philosopher called George Berkeley who coined the Latin phrase esse est percipi, which translates as to be is to be perceived. That kind of means nothing exists outside of your mind, or at least what you see only exists subjectively. If you're a brain in a box, if we are all brains in boxes, then maybe the universe we see is only what we've been programmed to believe. We're sure you've all seen the movie The Matrix, and that was written with this theory in mind. Okay, so this is a left-field intro for why there is a universe, but we felt it had to be said. And even if some alien civilization has concocted us and this is some kind of experiment for them, then they still exist inside something, just maybe it's not a universe like the one we know. Okay, back to planet Earth. So, science thinks it knows how the universe began. We're gonna simplify this beginning with a movie quote. It's from a British film called Naked, and a woman asks a man how he got here. She means to the house, but he sarcastically answers, well, basically there was this little dot, right? And the dot went bang, and the bang expanded. Energy formed into matter, matter cooled, matter lived, the amoeba to fish to fowl to frog to mammal, the mammal to monkey to man. So there you go, there was some kind of cosmic cataclysm, i.e. Big Bang. That little dot was very little, about 1 million billion billionth the size of an atom. About 13.7 billion years ago, it expanded, it burst open, and in about 1/100th of a billionth of a trillionth of a trillionth of a second, a short time indeed, there was this big burst known as inflation. It grew and grew and then started to cool down as it became less dense. And then, as the guy in the movie said, when it cooled enough, matter started to form. Over billions of years, the planets got themselves in order. Eventually on Earth, things crawled out of the primordial swamp and grew legs, and then in 2005 YouTube was founded, and that's why you're here. Well, to some extent. We should ask though, what on Earth is nothing? Because nothing has to be something, doesn't it? And if there was once nothing, why, oh why, oh why, did something come along? And this is where scientists started scratching their heads and shuffling papers, wondering if it's time to try out some DMT and look for answers there. Cosmologists or physicists or philosophers or part-time psychonauts or our mothers haven't been able to give us a fast answer as to why there is anything, but science has taken a stab at nothingness. Some scientists tell us that you can have nothing that isn't exactly something. Here we have to look at the field of quantum mechanics, which basically is the science of incredibly small things. In this field, you cannot just have totally immutably empty space. Even a vacuum is filled with small particles and something called antiparticles, and these, it's said, come into being and then disappear. You can't see them, but scientists know they're there because they have an effect when they do appear. It's like when you know someone's been in your room because your shoes have moved. This goes against to be is to be perceived, because something is, but no one can see it. By that rationale, there can be a nothing, but with something. Scientists say nothing is unstable, and so we got something. That something is the universe. Bear with us, we know this is confusing. If we didn't explain it that well, this is what the BBC says about it. Quantum mechanics tells us that nothing is inherently unstable, so the initial leap from nothing to something may have been inevitable. Then the resulting tiny bubble of space-time could have burgeoned into a massive, busy universe thanks to inflation. A scientist in that same article said that it is definitely plausible that our universe arose from nothing. No space, no time, no particles, nothing that we know of. There are things we cannot see, and so they don't exist, but they do exist. So maybe that's where existence sprang out of. There was nothing, but nothing didn't like being nothing, and so something came and something got busy. Billions of years later, and you're looking at your phone watching the Infographics show. On top of that, the universe keeps inflating, and some scientists believe universes outside our universe keep inflating too. This goes on forever, which is a strange word, as it's hard to really understand what forever means. We cannot grasp that, and we just usually call it infinity. The thing is, those other universes, if they exist, might have different dimensions than ours and be made out of different matter. That's if they exist, science isn't really sure. One man working at the Max Planck Institute for Nuclear Physics in Germany told the New Scientist that it's actually embarrassing that we don't know exactly why there is existence. In that article, it said we shouldn't exist at all, as antimatter and matter should have canceled each other out. But like a good Hollywood superhero movie, matter won, and we all lived happily, and occasionally sadly, ever after. According to science, matter overcame its nemesis, and that's why we're here. Yet, antimatter could very well have overcome matter, and even then we'd have an antimatter universe, not really different in any way from our present universe until it came in contact with regular matter, in which case the two would annihilate themselves and leave nothing behind. Yet that didn't happen, and the initial imbalance between matter and antimatter that led to the infant universe not annihilating itself is what has scientists puzzled. To date, there's no answer as to why an imbalance existed and thus prevented total annihilation. As for the more existential question we pondered at the beginning of the show as to why we exist, well, scientists would have you believe that we're just part and parcel of particles having a great big infinite party in space. We just are, for no other reason than we happened. Perhaps we're making a great big omelet, and there's something around the corner after, of course, we have smashed lots of eggs. Maybe there's a finishing line, ultimate progress, and we just have to keep plugging away. In philosophy, you might call this teleology, which simply means everything has a function and there's a goal, a finality. Maybe we all have a destiny and have a part to play in the big human drama, a la Game of Thrones, and there are some things our small brains just cannot fathom. Is life futile? Hell no. If everything suddenly seems pointless, you know there is someone out there you could hold a hand out to and put a smile on their face. You know you can create for other people, just as we are doing now. There may not be a reason for existing, but there are plenty of ways to exist. That's all that matters. And who knows, as we don't fully understand consciousness, maybe we're connected to each other and the universe in ways we still haven't figured out yet. We exist for reasons we're not quite sure of, but ain't that just the right reason to be ever curious, to celebrate existence, and if for a while, remember we're spinning on this rock in an ever-expanding universe, and to be enthralled by that. For as long as you can anyway, until that door closes in your mind and you have work to do, bills to pay, a leaky faucet to fix. We tackled some pretty big and complicated questions here, but you know what doesn't need to be complicated? Building a website. Luckily, Wix keeps things simple with their fully customizable templates and easy drag-and-drop interface. You can have a great-looking personal website in no time, and their robust design tools let you get as creative as you want. But if you don't have all the time in the universe, or maybe design just isn't your thing, their powerful ADI feature can whip up a fantastic-looking website in seconds just by having you answer a few simple questions. Get started with Wix today by visiting the link in the description or going to wix.com/go/infographics 2019. What do you think? Tell us your theory. Also, don't forget to watch our other video, What Happens When You Die? Thanks for watching, and as always, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you next time.